If I ask you this question, can you solve it? This is a really simple math problem. Everything here is constant except the blue ones like X, Y, Z, W. They are unknowns, the four unknowns, and I give you two equations. Can you solve it? Well, probably not. I mean, you cannot find the exact solutions for X, Y, Z, and W because you are lacking the information. And then with the exact same reason, if you close one of your eyes, try to match your fingertips like this, you can't really match it well if you ignore the sensory inputs from your muscle. It's not easy, it's challenging, and the reason is exactly the same as this math problem. So if you don't see the connection between this math problem and then this fingertip matching problem with your one eye closed, in this video, using this math, I'll demonstrate why having the two eyes allows for better perception of the world, not just for you and me, but also for our robots like computer vision. So let's dive in. And if you're new here, my name is Elliot. I'm a robotics engineer, educator, and my mission is to help people dive in this field of robotics as smooth as possible. Now let's go. Okay, so as an appetizer of today's video, I have prepared a string like this and five beads like this on a string. Of course, it's not an actual bead. It's just a random sponge that I just cut. Then there's no magic here. Then let me try to align one end on my left hand center at the camera lens. So once I center this end of the string, however I move the right hand, it's very difficult to see the beads behind of the first beads. Although the focus of the lens is kind of messing up because of autofocus, but anyway, that's my point. However I move the right hand, it's very difficult to see the other beads behind the first one. That's it. But if I say uncenter here like this, then you can kind of see the other beads like that. But once I center it again, it's very difficult to see. And yeah, sure, this wasn't a perfect experiment because we should have mathematically perfect line and the point to show my point, but you can kind of get it. Although these beads have some volumes, so obviously the beads in the behind the first one cannot be shown in the camera because it's blocking. And my question is, why is that? Light is always moving straight forward. And then this effect only happens once I center one of the tip of the string at the very center of the lens. If it is not centered well like this, you can kind of see it. And again, that's because the light is always moving straight line towards the center of the camera. And this behavior leads us to the model of camera, pinhole camera model. And before we talk about the pinhole camera model, have you ever wondered how this game engine renders the image of the camera in this 3D world like this? So inside this game engine, you have this camera, and then this camera view is like this. There is like white box, blue box, yellow box, and then they are all aligned at the center of the camera. So white box first and then blue box, and then behind the blue box there is yellow, and they are a little bit transparent, so yellow mixed with the blue, so it kind of looks like greenish. And my question is, if it is a game engine like Unity or Unreal game engine, how does this game engine renders this image of this camera? Have you ever wondered about that? Well, using the pinhole camera model, if you know the 3D coordinate of the real world, you can actually predict and calculate the 2D image point exactly if there is no noise in the camera lens or camera sensor. And then the calculation is pretty straightforward, except that we need to consider the homogeneous coordinate. And if you remember our very first experiment, as long as I center this string towards the center of the camera, every single point on this line maps onto the same pixel location of the image. And that's why you cannot see the beads behind the first beads, because the pixel location is the same. So unless the first piece is transparent, you cannot see the ones behind. So again, the point here is that along the line, every single point is the same, so same coordinate. And then mathematicians, scientists, engineers, these people always want to impress others. They call it homogeneous coordinate. So based on this pinhole camera model, all these rays, the light is coming here and then it reflected by the object, and then it gets into camera sensor like this, and then everything here kind of gets into center of the camera, and then it kind of like looks like a cone. And then you might be wondering how to actually convert Euclidean coordinate to homogeneous coordinate and then back and forth. Actually, mathematically, it's pretty trivial. Like you have X, Y, Z in the real world as a good old fashioned euclidean coordinate. You just need to put one at the end and voila, that's homogeneous coordinate. And then to convert it back to the euclidean coordinate, then you can just divide everything by the last dimension, and that is going to be your euclidean coordinate. And then in Python, it's really trivial. Euclidean to homogeneous coordinate, you just append one at the end, and whatever that is, homogeneous vector can be converted back to euclidean coordinate using this one line of code. You just divide everything by the last vector, and then only discard the last vector. And if you're really curious more about this mathematical definition and geometry, you can refer to this book, Multiple View Geometry. When you do computer vision and image projection, this kind of geometric operation, almost everything is done in the homogeneous coordinate. And then after all this calculation is done, you convert it back to the euclidean coordinate so that you can actually predict the pixel location in X and Y or real world coordinate in X, Y, Z. So once you can convert the real world X, Y, Z into the homogeneous coordinate like this by putting one, and then you can actually calculate homogeneous coordinate of the image for XY, small XY, W or Z, and then just divide by W, and that's going to be your pixel location. And that's how this game engine renders the image inside of the game. And these values, focal length XY, and then the center point XY is unique to your camera and your image setting. And then in practice, you'll be given with these numbers. So you just need to do matrix multiplication in Python, which is another one line of code, and then you can calculate it. And I knew you didn't trust me, so I have prepared this stereo camera, left and right eyes. And I'm going to place this camera over there in front of the wall. And then let me actually measure. If you can see, there is a ruler like that. I'm going to measure the distance to that ruler, and then there is actually a red sticker there. So I'm going to measure the 3D point of that red point relative to this camera. So based on this tape ruler, I'm not sure if you can see, the distance was about 128 centimeters, which is a little more than 4 feet. This is the view from the camera. Then I attached this 30 centimeter ruler, or it's about a feet. And then there's a little red marker here. So I know that this camera center is looking at this cross section here. So I know world coordinate of this red sticker is negative 30 centimeter towards the left. So it's negative. And let's assume this Y coordinate is just perfect zero. I have written down the numbers like this. Okay, my webcam is mirrored, so it looks mirrored, but you know what I mean. So that's the coordinate I actually measured relative to the camera. Now let's actually predict the image, 2D image pixel coordinate of this real world coordinate using Python. And then as you can see, I have prepared Python code like this. And then these two are this conversion between the euclidean and then homogeneous coordinates. And then I have defined my focal length and the camera center. We can talk about it in the future video, but for now, these values are given, which is the camera parameter matrix. And then the values are like this. And then I'm going to define the world coordinate in terms of euclidean coordinate. So my X value was negative 300 millimeters. And then let's assume Y is just zero. And then Z axis is 1280 millimeters. So if I just run this, then after all this, the last value is the image coordinate, which is predicted to be. So let me turn on this, and then let's click somewhere here. And then 465, 359. I think that's really close to the actual value from the image, except that there are some noise, and then I couldn't click exactly where it is, right? But I think these are really good prediction to me. So what I have done so far is this. I've measured like X as negative 300 millimeters, Y was zero, and Z was 1280 millimeters, right? And then I just put one to make it as homogeneous coordinate. And I got all these camera parameter matrix values. And then I was able to predict the pixel location on the image. And that's all I have done. And then that was in the matrix form. And then if I just write all these matrix calculation as a couple lines of equation, it's this equation. I was able to calculate the 2D image coordinate, which is x prime, y prime here. And then I measured the real world coordinate x, y, z, and then w was just 1. And then I was able to calculate this left hand side. And I have proven that. And then obviously, the next thing that we want to do is, without measuring the real world coordinate, by only looking at this image coordinate, can we backtrack this blue x, y, z in the real world? And then that's the exact equation we have seen from the very beginning of the video, and that we knew that we can't solve it because we have 4 unknowns and 2 equations. So how can we do it? Well, remember, these 2 equations is coming from 1 camera. If you just add 1 more camera, you'll have another 2 lines of equations. And then we have 4 equations with 4 unknowns that we can solve for x, y, z, and w. And that's why I'm arguing that just add 1 more camera, like stereo camera system. Stereo camera is coming with 2 cameras. And because you have built it, the manufacturer built it, or you can build it, and you know the distance between the 2 cameras. So that is known value. And then you can backtrack the triangulator a certain point in the image. How? Again, another camera gives you 2 more lines of equation to this equation. So you have 4 unknowns with 4 equations you can solve it. So that's the connection between math and the physical phenomena and coding all together. And I have been telling you, you need to connect between math and the physical phenomena. You need to really understand what's going on and then try to express that in terms of math. And even before you notice, you're going to be pretty solid, well-grounded robotics engineer. So let's keep going. So according to this book, we can actually triangulate a physical point in a homogeneous coordinate using 2 cameras like this, because you know the distance between the 2 cameras like that, and then you know the camera parameter like this, and then another camera can see the exact same point from another view. So definitely you can backtrack it. Now here I have this image from the left camera, and then I have another image from the right camera. So if you can see here, the right camera is on the right side of it, so it doesn't see all these curtain on the window. Unlike left image, the right image is a little more on the right side. So that's the left and right image. Now let me click this red sticker here. No, somewhere like that. And then the coordinate, the same point on the right image is 3D point of this red sticker. I have prepared this. So let me plug in 463, like that. And then I put 1 because I need to convert it back to homogeneous coordinate to be able to calculate all this. So if I run this, I have 1.12 meters. And then I have about 0.2 meters, which it should be negative 0.3, but there's about 5-ish centimeters, which is about 1 inch or 2 inches, something like that. And that's because I think the noise is in this point. So I put a better coordinate. So I got this number, which is closer to 30 centimeter, which is negative 0.3 meters, and then almost 0 for y-axis, and then 1.14 meters. It should be more like 1.2 meters, but the error is small in this case. So I accept it. And then what I'm doing here is just literally solving that 4 equation with the 4 unknowns, and then I just put this in a matrix form, and then I just solve as VD. And then this is just number that came out. So if you can calculate all these 3D points for every single point on the image, you can actually create a depth map or calculate the depth in the scene. So if I click this red dot here, so it automatically calculates the X, Y, and Z coordinate of that point on the pixel of the image using the stereo camera. So if I click back there on the wall, it's further than this drawer. Like that, you can see this Z value changes. So that's how you can actually measure the depth for the scene, especially for your robot. And that's why we need 2 eyes to match the fingers so that we can measure the depth better, and so do your robots. Now you understand how to measure the depth using this camera for your robot. And then if you have this kind of ability, what did you do for your robot? I might put this camera onto my drone or RC rover and then try to build a autonomous navigation algorithm for my robots. So in the next video, let's talk about the visual diametry algorithm, which is one of the basic level of autonomous navigation. So if you like this kind of content, please hit the like button and then subscribe to my channel if you haven't yet. So I can keep unloading this kind of content. And then I'll see you in the next video for the visual diametry algorithm. So stay tuned. My name is Elliot. I'll see you around.